My name is Marlies Wakkee. I'm a dermatologist and associate professor at the Erasmus MC Cancer Institute. So today I'm presenting this lecture on skin cancer on behalf of the Academic Center of Excellence on Skin Cancer of the Erasmus MC. So did you know that currently one in every two diagnosed cancers is skin cancer? So these numbers are enormous. So currently 70,000 people in the Netherlands get every year a diagnosis of skin cancer. So this means that we really have to be aware of research that is focused on both determining the causes, but also the treatment of patients with skin cancer. So at our A skin cancer, we do not only treat and do research and provide education on patients with advanced skin cancer, but we also see our responsibility for the skin cancer care in the rest of the Netherlands. So as you can see, we have a lot of connections with different partners, and one of those connections is with other care institutions, where we have set up a skin cancer network called Huidkompas, where our aim is that it's both visible for patients as well as care provider, which type of skin cancer care is provided at which institute. So it provides a transparent way of providing care to skin cancer patients. But we also, besides only evaluating care at our own institute, we also aim at evaluating care, for example, on a national level, where we use routine databases such as the National the Netherlands Cancer Registry, or the PALGA database, and the Dutch Melanoma Treatment Registry. We also collaborate with private partners, and we also have a collaboration within the Convergence with Delft and the Erasmus School of Health Policy and Management. So before we continue with more information on the research that we conduct at our ACE, I want to introduce you the three types of most common skin cancers that we have in the Netherlands. So in case of basal cell carcinoma, there are almost 50,000 new patients each year. So the incidence is enormous and very high, but the risk of developing metastasis is very low. So in case of basal cell carcinoma, the aim is especially to improve the efficiency of care. Well, in melanoma, it's more focused on reducing mortality. The second type of skin cancer is squamous cell carcinoma, from which we have almost 12,000 new patients each year, and the risk of metastasis is between 2 and 5%. And the most aggressive type of skin cancer is melanoma, where we still have 6,000 new patients per year, and approximately one in every five patients has one a certain type of advanced melanoma. So we perform a lot of research focused on predicting progression and also preventing progression of disease. So progression is an important item in skin cancer research. So there are three types of prevention. So the first type of prevention is primary prevention. So in skin cancer, this means reducing UV exposure. So in practice, this means that we collaborate in various campaigns organized by the Dutch Society of Dermatologists. We participate in national programs to reduce UV exposure, and we also take our responsibility when we work in when there are media campaigns related to UV exposure and being aware of skin cancer, and we have an advisory role for the United Nations environmental protection with regard to UV exposure. So the secondary prevention is related to early identification of high-risk patients. So we know that screening in skin cancer in the whole population is not a cost-effective way of screening. But it could be interesting, of course, if we can identify those patients who have a high risk of skin cancer. So we participated in various cohorts and cohort studies where we performed GWAS studies, for example, among patients with skin cancer. And we found multiple genetic mutations that were both related to cell proliferation or cell immunity, but also they were related to skin tanning ability, for example. So therefore, the phenotype is also very important. So we also collaborated in other GWAS studies and showed genetic mutations related to UV sensibility or skin tanning or hair color. So I think this is a really interesting way to identify high-risk patients based on their phenotype. Right now there are even websites where you can enter your genetic profile and you can get a genetic risk estimation of your risk of skin cancer. Another type of secondary prevention is in patients with actinic keratosis. So this means those are the patients where the skin already shows that the patients have had a lot of UV exposure. So actinic keratosis, as you can see on the picture, are patients with rough scaly patches. And you can also feel them when you're stroking your grandfather's head with these rough lesions. And those are pre-malignant lesions, and we know that they are related to the risk of skin cancer. So, we've evaluated in the Rotterdam study that the prevalence is really high. So in the Rotterdam study, all participants were aged 45 and older, and we found that half of all men and almost a quarter of all women had at least one or multiple actinic keratosis. So what's then interesting, of course, is how this relates to the risk of skin cancer. And as you can see over here, the number of actinic keratosis is related to the risk of skin cancer. So you see the numbers increasing with an increasing number of actinic keratosis. So therefore, we also wanted to develop a risk prediction model for patients with actinic keratosis. So we therefore included both clinical characteristics as well as environmental characteristics. And we found that both the number of actinic keratosis, the location, but also coffee consumption was related to the risk of developing skin cancer. And coffee consumption is a really interesting finding, and it could be a biological plausible reason. There is some literature on it. On the protective effect of caffeine, but it could also be that coffee consumption might be related to some kind of lifestyle, and perhaps these are the people who are more have more inside jobs and less UV exposure. So this is something that really needs further exploration. The third type of prevention is prevention of patients to have disease progression. And in skin cancer, this can be two types of prevention, which in basal cell carcinoma is much related to the occurrence of multiple basal cell carcinomas. Because we found that that among patients with a basal cell carcinoma, approximately one third of all patients developed multiple tumors. So it's not a metastasis, but it's just a secondary new tumor. So we also, in this population, we also developed a prediction model. And you can see that we have three risk categories. And again, also in this group, the location of the tumor, the subtype of basal cell carcinoma, but again, also coffee consumption was protective, and age and gender were all in this model. And this can help to identify who are the patients that we need to follow up very carefully. Another type of prevention in melanoma, tertiary prevention, of course, means the prevention of disease progression into metastasis. So over the past years, a lot of things have changed in melanoma care. So based on the melanoma invasion depth and the presence of ulceration, we currently make an evaluation or a stratification who should get a central lymph node biopsy. And the central lymph node biopsy informs us on the risk of a patient to develop metastasis. Here you can see that we have improved this risk prediction by using the Rotterdam criteria, because now not only the presence or absence of a positive or negative central lymph node was shown to be predictive of the risk of having metastasis, but it was also related to the melanoma tumor burden that was found in the central lymph node. So the central lymph node burden, which was at the beginning only a prognostic marker, has now changed into a therapeutic marker, because the treatment of patients with melanoma has improved significantly over the past years with the introduction of immunotherapy and other systemic therapies. Therefore, it's even more important to identify those patients who have a positive central lymph node biopsy. An interesting new development in tertiary prevention is that we're now also able to better identify who are the patients who actually have this positive or negative central lymph node biopsy. And by this, we include also data on the genetic profile. So we developed a clinical pathological gene expression profile, and we evaluated this also in our own patient database. And here you can see the effect of such a genetic profile, because this way we can identify who are the patients who have a negative sentinel lymph node biopsy. So that's the aim of this model. So this way, those patients do not have to undergo a sentinel lymph node biopsy anymore. So when we evaluated this in our own data set, you can see that at first, when we evaluate the risk of a positive sentinel lymph node biopsy, approximately a quarter of all patients has a positive sentinel lymph node biopsy. However, after including the gene expression profile, you can see that only among the high-risk patients, this risk increased to almost one-third of all patients, while those who had a low-risk outcome had only a very low risk of having a positive sentinel lymph node biopsy. So another interesting thing, of course, when we talk about such high numbers in skin cancer, are the cost of skin cancer. And here you can see that the cost of skin cancer have really increased over the past years. And we evaluated that this is both related to the increased number of skin cancer patients, but are also related to the increased use of expensive systemic therapies, which you can see in the increasing green bars in this figure. So therefore, we conduct a lot of research related to this, both the volume as well as the cost of skin cancer care. So when you talk about high volume disease, it's important to increase the efficiency of the care path of patients with skin cancer. So when a person has a suspicious lesion at home, they usually go to their GP, who evaluates the skin cancer and determines if a person has to go, for example, should be referred to a dermatologist, or the GP would treat the patients themselves. However, we found that among all lesions that were suspicious according to the GP, only one-third were actually skin cancer. However, the GP referred almost two-thirds of all patients directly to the dermatologist. So there's a lot of efficiency that we can improve over here. So this means that we want to prevent those patients who do not have skin cancer for getting into care, but also to make sure that the right patients with skin cancer get into care. Because we also, for example, found that the sensitivity of a GP to diagnose skin cancer is around 40%. So an interesting technological innovation in that area is therefore the use of artificial intelligence. And this is increasingly used over the past years and is also integrated, for example, in a mobile telephone. So it's mobile health combined with artificial intelligence. And we collaborate for that with Skin Vision. And we found that when we validated the use of this app at our own outpatient clinic and also at the Albert Schweitzer Hospital, we had a sensitivity of almost 90% to detect skin cancer. But the specificity was a little bit lower, around 70%. But I think this will be a future development that would be very important to increase the efficiency of skin cancer care and the care for patients with suspicious skin lesions. However, it is interesting, of course, where we should position such a development. And therefore, we collaborate with the European School of Health Policy and Management to determine where we should position such a development, what's the cost effectiveness of this development, and the legitimacy. So will people actually use such an app? Another way of looking at the cost of skin cancer care is related to the treatment of the skin cancer itself. So usually patients with skin cancer get a conventional excision. In case of a conventional excision, there are some vertical cuts on Breedlove evaluation of a skin cancer lesion. So this way, as you can see also over here, you could miss some skin cancer, and this increases the risk of a recurrence in the future. However, I think most micrographic surgery, which is a technique that we perform a lot at the Erasmus MC Cancer Institute, is a really nice treatment for patients with high-risk skin cancer. And as you can see, this allows us to evaluate the whole layer that we have cut out, and we can exactly see where there's still skin cancer. And there we can then perform a second round, and then we make sure that the skin cancer is completely removed from the patient, and then we can perform the reconstruction. So we evaluated the impact of performing Mohs surgery for high-risk skin lesions. And this was already before evaluated in patients with a basal cell carcinoma. And here you can see that, here you can see the upper line is the blue line, is that the risk of a recurrence is much lower in patients that were treated with Mohs micrographic surgery. So this difference increases up to 10% after almost 10 years. So we continued with this, evaluating this now in patients with cutaneous squamous cell carcinoma. And also here you can see that it's just the graphs are the other way around, but you can see that Mohs micrographic surgery, which is the dotted line, has a lower risk of a recurrence compared to patients who had a standard excision of their squamous cell carcinoma. So if a patient has an incompletely excised squamous cell carcinoma, we know that their risk is much higher to develop a recurrent tumor. It's around 40 or 50%. And it also increases the risk of developing metastasis. So I think these are very interesting techniques to include in your in the evaluation of skin cancer care. And also when it's when a tumor is treated this way, we can decide that the patient does not need any follow-up anymore because the tumor is completely removed. So this also brings us to the next topic, which is the follow-up care of patients with low-risk basal cell carcinoma. So overall, the evidence for conducting follow-up visits in patients with skin cancer is rather low. And this is relates actually to all types of cancers. But in case of low-risk basal cell carcinoma, together we have decided, and it's also written in the Dutch guidelines, that patients with a low-risk basal cell carcinoma do not need follow-up visits. However, these are almost 25,000 patients in the Netherlands each year. But we found that in our research, a lot of patients actually do get follow-up visits. And therefore, this was one of the topics that was picked up by Doen of Laten, or to do or not to do, aimed at reducing these low-risk follow-up visits. So what we conducted is extensive qualitative research. We performed interviews with patients, care providers, and evaluated how which were the strategies to reduce these follow-up visits. And we found, for example, and we found that based on also a discrete choice experiment, that a personalized information leaflet was the most feasible way to reduce this risk of, to reduce the need for follow-up visits. So we tested this also in six healthcare institutes, and we found that compared to care as usual, patients who had the addition of the personalized information leaflet, they had a 15% lower risk of lower need of having a follow-up visit. And then when we also calculated a budget impact analysis, and we found that when we when this is extrapolated to the rest of the Netherlands, we can save almost 2.7 million euros over 5 years. So therefore, currently, we're now also collaborating with Registratie aan de Bron to see whether we can scale this up in the rest of the Netherlands. So the cost of skin cancer are also related to the use of systemic drugs in patients, especially with melanoma. And we found that, for example, the cost of a treatment episode of a patient with a melanoma can be as high as 80,000 euros per treatment episode. So therefore, it's important to constantly evaluate the cost and the benefits of a systemic therapy. So I think a very nice collaboration is therefore with within the Dutch Melanoma Treatment Registry, where the use of systemic drugs is evaluated in a real-life population. For example, recently it was evaluated whether systemic drugs were also cost-efficient and a safe treatment option in patients with autoimmune diseases. And also a very nice trial, which is conducted by Dr. van der Veld at our hospital, is the Safe Stop trial, which is a national study where it is evaluated that patients who have a good response on immune therapy can discontinue their treatment at an earlier phase than was initially done in the in the trials that were used to register these systemic drugs. Also, the clinical pathological gene expression profile was an interesting development during the COVID pandemic. So we set up a national study where we now evaluate where patients who have a low risk of a positive central lymph node biopsy can be safely postponed the central lymph node biopsy. And in this way, care could continue for those patients who have a high risk of a positive central lymph node biopsy. And also the Safe Stop study, where we evaluated if patients can discontinue their treatment at an earlier stage, is of course very interesting to reduce the pressure on the hospitals and to reduce the need for a patient to visit the hospital for their melanoma. So I hope I have been able to demonstrate you that at our ACE Skin Cancer, we do not only perform research, education, and patient care related to patients with advanced skin cancer, but that we also collaborate with many different partners and care institutions, and also within the convergence of the TU Delft and the European School of Health Policy and Management to improve our knowledge on skin cancer care and therefore improve the care of patients with skin cancer. Thank you for your attention.